are under attack. What do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
I was approved by the president of the General Assembly to speak because I know I'm not an international celebratory. I'm not the head of another international NGO. I do not have access to governments or the wealthy and the powerful people. And I don't have an uplifting story to tell that make it possible to believe that poverty can be solved by scaling up skill or growth or credit. My story is not a story of facts to riches. The story is just a fairy tales told to us to make us sleepy and sleeping. My story is not a remarkable one. It is quite unremarkable, in fact. It is a story that is shared by millions of women around the world, the poor women of the world. It is unglamorous, common story of poverty, exploitation, migration, and discrimination. When I was young, I had hopes and dreams for education, career, and prosperity. I wanted to contribute to my family, my society, and allow my parents to grow old in comfort and dignity. We just have emerged from years of dictatorship, and we believe that we would finally be able to determine our own future and end crony capitalism. But unfortunately, that did not happen. The Asian financial crisis in 1997 brought a new form of crony capitalism, what imposed by International Monetary Fund designed to protect the interests of the financier, surround funds, and multinational corporations. We were forced into austerity, and families like mine paid a high price for that. Education became unaffordable. The cost of water, food, healthcare, transportation, and all services are actually skyrocketed. Public assets were privatized and become inaccessible to most of us. Like many, my parents went into debt and eventually had to give up the small business to give us livelihood. I didn't even enter university, but there were also no decent jobs out there that I can work for, and many unemployed. I was left with no choice but to migrate to Hong Kong and become a domestic worker, to help my siblings stay in school and my family to survive the crisis. But the promises made by recruitment agencies proved another fairy tale to me. Indonesian migrant domestic workers are confined and made to sign loan agreement. We were in fact indebted even before we leave our countries. Our wages are thinly denied and we suffer tremendous exploitative working conditions. I quickly realized no matter how long I work, 19 hours a day, on call 24 hours, I was not going to receive the salary I deserve. If I could wish, I wish my experience doesn't happen to others, doesn't happen to other young women like me. Let it be my own journey. However, reality speaks otherwise. I saw more young women were exploited, tortured, and murdered. Last year alone, a friend of mine, a fellow young Indonesian woman at Vienna, she was actually brutally tortured by her employer. She was confined for 7 months unpaid, not even able food, only 2 slices of bread a day, a bottle of water. She was left to sleep on the floor. And when she was so weak, she was just sent back home silently. She was enslaved in the city that always promised to protect us, the domestic worker. My story, and Rihanna's story, unfortunately happened again and again and again. Since the millennium declaration was signed, millions more women were forced into migration and into exploitative working conditions. We are the engine of the economic growth, the ASEAN miracle, yet we do not enjoy this benefit. We were not even married to have those. We are living in the world
when multinational corporations have captured our resources, our labor, our land, our democracy. Their wealth is dependent on our exploitation. We have produced growth, but 95% of the income of the growth has gone to the richest 40%. That unfortunately doesn't even include us. We live in the world where half of the wealth of the world is owned by only 1% of the global population. 67% own 3.5 billion. And their wealth, their consumption, their greed is not just coming at the expense of our labor, land and lives, but making this planet uninhabitable. They are the real cause of this climate change. The sustainable development goals include target where we all agree with and fought very hard. But despite all the best efforts, they still insist on growth and continuation of inherently unfair and exploitative system. There is a chance to even introduce a universal living wage. There is a chance to develop a global tax body. There is a chance to review and stop the trade agreement when it is actually harmful to humanity. There is a chance to change the economic system that depends on produce exploitation. If there is a remarkable chapter in my story, it is not one of the individual triumph, but one of the collectivity, of solidarity, of the power of the movement. My own experience inspired me to work with other women exploited by the employers and by this unfair system. I started organizing the Indonesian and also later on in the International Migrants Alliance. And this is a real story of change. Through movement, we have made small increases in the wages and livelihood of domestic workers. We saw the employer of Indiana lock up in the prison. The only way to achieve our rights and the world we want is really to organize, to act collectively, yes, and to use the power of a just demand, the power of the 99%, the power of labor to completely dismantle the system. And that is why People's General Assembly is so important. And I hope the future we will have it outdoor there, witnessed by thousands of New Yorkers can join us. We have to start imagining ways to use the power of the many and the tyranny of this wealthy. We are here because another world is possible. And to quote Arundhati Roy, she is on her way. Thank you.
When migrant rights are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
When migrant rights are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back!